associated with MABS and immunomodulating agents. We have three speakers tonight, which will this morning, which will be introduced by my co-chair, Dr. Arlene Macabaya. After which, may we ask the speakers, the three speakers in the platter, to stay here in front and be seated. Thank you.
Morning, everyone. So this morning, I'll introduce to you our three speakers, and I'll be asking these three speakers to please come up to the stage as I call each one of them, and they will be called in the order of their presentation. So our first speaker for this morning is Dr. Saibel Lara R. Abad. She's a research collaborator and assistant professor of the Mayo Clinic, a clinical associate professor of the UPPGH, an infectious diseases consultant at the Medical City, and she's the chairman of the Infection Control Committee, the Medical City, Pasig City. Please, let's all welcome Dr. Saibel Lara R. Abad. Our second speaker is Dr. Raymond R. Razonable. He's a consultant, Division of Infectious Diseases, Department of Internal Medicine, Mayo Clinic, Rochester, Minnesota. He's a professor of medicine from the Mayo Clinic College of Medicine and Science. He's the chair of the Community Infectious Diseases Practice, Department of Medicine, Division of Infectious Diseases. He's also the vice chair, Division of Infectious Diseases, Department of Internal Medicine, Mayo Clinic. Please, let's welcome Dr. Raymond Razonable. And last but not the least, we have Dr. Raquel Victoria Ekarma. She's the section head, infectious diseases of the Veterans Memorial Medical Center, the section head, infectious diseases, National Kidney and Transplant Institute, the head of the Infection Control Committee of Capital Medical Center, and the head of the Infection Control Committee of the National Kidney and Transplant Institute. Dr. Raquel Victoria Ekarma. So may I please call in all three speakers to go up the stage. So may we call on Dr. Abad to start the session.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks for having me. I was asked to talk about biologics and the risk of infection for just 20 minutes. I have no financial disclosures, but I will mention brand names and off-label use of some biologic agents for familiarity. You may be more familiar with some of their brand names. Most of this information in this discussion are really taken from the ECMID study group consensus document, which was just published this year in June, and it's actually a very good collection of articles, so you can download this at your own time. The following is the outline of my presentation. We will go over just the overview of biologics first, and then we'll go over some case vignettes. Hopefully we'll learn about some infectious disease associations, prophylaxis, vaccination, and then in each case we'll have a summary slide, and then we'll end with some take-home points. So just a brief background. Biologic agents are increasingly being used in the treatment of several diseases, and it really has changed the way we manage medical diseases such as rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, psoriatic arthritis, etc. Biologics, in general, apply to any biologically derived product. Now, as the name implies, it comes from living organism. It refers to a class of drugs, which includes monoclonal antibodies and other molecules, which mimic or copy their molecular agents. So in essence, there are small molecules which are low in weight and are chemically synthesized, and they become more complex, and they become monoclonal antibodies, which are high molecular weight and derived from living organisms. And this is the focus of our discussion here. Interestingly, there's actually some science to the way they name these MABs. So they all pretty much sound alike. But if it comes from a mouse, there's an O preceding the MAB. So it's, for example, muromonomab. If it's chimeric, meaning it comes from a mouse and human derived, it's XI, so it's rituximab. So there's some science behind it. And if it's human derived, for example, it's adalimumab, it's a U before the MAB. Okay, so I didn't really know where to start because a lot of biologic agents. So I did my own version of Family Feud, and I asked my favorite rheumatologists, hematologists, oncologists, what their top five commonly used biologic agents are. So the top five, apparently, here in the Philippines are as follows. So rituximab is very popular. It's an anti-CD20 agent. Infliximab, etanercept belong to the same class. And secukinumab and pembrolizumab are also used, but actually they're not very, they don't have a very good risk with infection or association with infection. So I replaced them with some other agents that I think you should know about as infectious disease physicians. So what are the general principles? How do you approach a patient on a biologic? In general, they're actually overall pretty safe. We just get the ones that are sicker. But in general, they all get injection site or infusion reactions. And biologics are a lookup, meaning if you have a patient on a biologic, you have to look up the biologic. Because there are so many, they sound alike, you can be confused, and you have to review prior and present treatment regimens. Because they are almost never given alone. And the infection risk is confounded depending on what other agents they're on. So usually they're on steroids or other agents as well. Now, some are associated with specific infections, which we will go over, and I'll try to highlight these for you. Unfortunately, the duration of susceptibility for these for a patient on a biologic is not clear. And so how long we prophylax these patients is also unclear, and that there's not much guidance there. The increased risk of infection is broadly categorized into serious infections, which is kind of a hodgepodge of bacterial respiratory infections, viruses, etc. But opportunistic infections are separate. So we'll focus more on the opportunistic infections. So let's start with a case. We have a 54-year-old male with history of severe RA, comes in for infectious disease clearance, so very popular reason for consult, prior to starting infliximab. He's otherwise healthy, but he tells you he has a scar on his lung, again, a popular problem amongst our patients. He's PPD positive. He does not recall any TB exposure or history of TB treatment. So the question now to you is, will you clear him? So before you do that, you must be familiar with infliximab. So infliximab is a TNF-alpha inhibitor, right? It belongs to this class of agents. You might know it as Remicade, or Enbrel, or Humira, or other similar names. Now, they're usually approved for arthritis, psoriatic arthritis, plaque psoriasis, etc. But remember, they're also used for graft-versus-host disease, uveitis, Behçet's, and other indications. No? So they kind of use it as a last regimen. So what happens when you inhibit TNF-alpha? So what is TNF-alpha for? So TNF-alpha is a cytokine, right, which is which works in adaptive immune responses and helps with the formation of granulomas, in activation and differentiation of macrophages, and immune response against viral pathogens. So you can imagine, if you take it away, what types of infection your patient will get. So as an example, our favorite example, as always, is TB. So when you have a TB bacilli down below, which is in light pink, you're exposed to it, automatically your macrophages are activated. And these macrophages will in turn activate interferon gamma, which is up on top, and TNF, which will activate your cell-mediated immunity, which is your T helper cell, right in the middle of the screen. Uh-huh. And then it will kill the bacilli. But unfortunately, some of these bacilli escape, and your body is forced to form an adaptive response, which is basically the formation of granuloma, which is made up of both macrophages and T cells. If you have a T cell depleting agent, which is in the box, or a TNF-alpha inhibitor, what happens is this granuloma will dissolve. And there you go, you spread and activate TB. So given this, there's actually very strong association with infliximab and TB reactivation, as seen in multiple meta-analysis and randomized controlled trials. So the odds of increasing TB reactivation are anywhere from 3.5 to as high as 17, depending on the population, how long they've been on the agent, the age, comorbidities, etc. As an example, these are the kind of the more recent meta-analysis and randomized controlled trials. OLE is open label extension study. And so the risk estimate for reactivation TB is anywhere from 3.53 to 17. The study below was a multi-center registry. It did not find any increased risk for TB, but they think this was because it was a younger population and they had not been on TNF-alpha for very long. So going back to our patient, this patient should then be thoroughly evaluated for TB and active TB ruled out before starting infliximab. Locally, we actually have some guidance which was published by our rheumatology colleagues, but this was back in 2006, and I have not yet found an update. Essentially, what they want us to do is to look for TB in the patient and amongst his family members, And then you treat active or latent TB according to guidelines. If you can, you have to delay treatment with infliximab, especially if it's active TB. And then if it's just latent TB, then administer prophylaxis, which was the contention yesterday in the debate. But this is an immune-compromised host. So in summary, these are some of the other associated infections for TNF-alpha. So hepatitis B is another big association. If you're Hep B surface antigen positive, or if you're core positive, then you would give prophylaxis with entecavir or a similar agent. There are no recommendations for PCP prophylaxis at this time or for endemic fungi. You could potentially give acyclovir for antiviral prophylaxis, but that's case to case, and there's no strong recommendation for this. So looking back, so those are OIs, but for serious infections in the middle, you can see that there's a gamut. There's very different infections that are associated with these agents, mainly pulmonary respiratory disease, sepsis, etc. For infliximab, for example, listeria, which is an intracellular pathogen, is also well documented. Okay, so second case. So we have a 56-year-old female with non-Hodgkin's and old hepatitis B who recently finished a course of rituximab. She's referred because she's now complaining of nausea, fever, and ecteric sclerae. So now you have to know what rituximab is. It sounds like infliximab, but it's actually a very different drug. So this one is an anti-CD20, and it's used for B-cell positive malignancies, such as lymphoma, and other orphan autoimmune diseases. What it does is it modulates B and T-cell interactions rather than a direct effect on humoral immunity. So just to give you a brief overview of the class, so rituximab is the most popular, but there are other OMABs down below, which are not yet available here. Off-label uses include, again, treatment for graft versus host disease, lupus, post-transplant lymphoproliferative disorders, etc. So the big association with rituximab, if you hear it, you think hepatitis B, which is kind of what's going on with this patient. So what happens is it reactivates both chronic and apparently resolved hepatitis B, and the odds of reactivation are close to 6. There's a 6-fold increase. So in essence, you should offer antiviral prophylaxis to to anybody who's Hep B surface antigen positive or anti-Hep B core positive. No? And then you should give prophylaxis for about 12 to 18 months after the last administration of the CD20 agent. And then once they're off prophylaxis, you should still monitor for about a year and see if they will reactivate. So it's kind of a delayed response. There's another peculiar condition associated with these anti-CD20 agents called late onset neutropenia. So what happens is your patient becomes neutropenic and then they recover their neutrophils, but then about 1 to 5 months after that, their neutrophils start to drop again. So this occurs in about 5 to 15% of patients with rituximab and agents from this class. It can persist for a few months. Some resolve spontaneously, but some just persists. But whether or not this increases the risk of infection is still unclear. So there's no guidance in terms of whether you should put them back on prophylaxis because of the prolonged neutropenia. So summarizing these agents, looking at opportunistic infections. So for viruses, you can consider prophylaxis, but there's no strong recommendation for it. Really, the strong recommendation is for hepatitis B. For PCP, you can consider prophylaxis because there are some reports of increased PCP risk with patients on rituximab. But when you look at the data closely, you find that the risk is associated with the accompanying regimen, which is usually steroids. Now, looking at serious infections, there's really a whole lot of them that can happen. There's a black box for PML and rituximab. So rituximab, think hepatitis B and think PML. So next case, we have a 55-year-old male with CLL who's treated with alemtuzumab. So what infectious disease prophylaxis would be appropriate? So none. It depends on the patient's CD4 count. Trimethoprim sulfa or cotrimoxazole and valacyclovir, INH, and voriconazole. So again, what is alemtuzumab? You have to be familiar with the agent. So it's a humanized, remember it's UMAB, so it's humanized, and it binds to CD52. And then it leads to cell lysis by cell-mediated cytotoxicity. So what does, essentially, it severely depletes both T cells and B cells. So it has a big impact on your CD4 cells, and people know this as AIDS in a bottle. So you're basically giving your patient HIV. Okay. So then you think about HIV-associated illnesses. No? Its approved indications are for CLL, like in this case, but again, off-label use for graft-versus-host disease and induction therapy or graft rejection for solid organ transplants. So going back to our case, so considering that you're giving your patient HIV, in essence, what would your answer be? So for the fellows, so it's like an HIV patient, right? You give cotri prophylaxis, and you can give viral prophylaxis as well, so valacyclovir. No? There's no strong indication yet to give INH, but perhaps in this setting, you might consider giving INH. No? So in summary, alemtuzumab, no? So you screen for viruses, you give antiviral prophylaxis for CMV, and I'll show you in the next slide. You can either give prophylaxis or do preemptive therapy, which is basically you monitor and wait for the CMV to come. Now, again, strong recommendation to prophylax against PCP. There's also a strange association with HPV. If you look at the bottom of the table, you should do yearly screening because they found HPV reactivation, and you should definitely give them the HPV vaccine before starting alemtuzumab. So for solid organ transplant recipients, there's very good recommendations regarding monitoring for alemtuzumab and T-cell depleting agents, as follows. So again, PCP prophylaxis for about 6 months. For CMV, it depends on your donor and your recipient status. For EBV, you monitor basically EBV PCR. And for hepatitis C, you do some monitoring as well. So next case. So 41-year-old male with PNH this time. He's on some meds for the PNH, he can't recall. He developed fever, headache, nausea, photophobia, and vomiting when he was traveling back to the U.S. from Germany. No? So when he arrived, he was brought immediately to the hospital. So they did some CSF, initial gram stain was negative, but blood cultures grew gram negative diplococci. So what, first question is, what do you think he's on? Because he can't remember. And then what do you think is going on? So there's something going on because he's febrile, he's got a headache, and photophobia, so sort of a meningitis, no? So what agent is he on? So what do you give for PNH? So patients these days are given eculizumab, no? And there's approximately a 10,000-fold increase in meningococcal infection when you're on this agent with an overall incidence of about 1.5%. So what does eculizumab do? It's actually a recombinant, so it's ZU, remember, a humanized monoclonal antibody that acts on C5. So it's the first-in-class agent that blocks the formation of C5. So it essentially, it prevents the conversion of C5 to C5B, which then leads to your membrane attack complex. No? So going back to your basic immunology, look at this slide here. So the complement is activated by the classical pathway, lectin or alternative pathway, but all roads lead to C5. No? Parang natatraffic siya sa C5. Okay, so C5 is blocked. It can't be converted to C5B, and so you can't form your membrane attack complex. So when you're on eculizumab, you should give penicillin or fluoroquinolone prophylaxis for about 4 weeks or until you document antibodies. No? You should also vaccinate your patients 2 to 4 weeks prior to starting this agent, and if they're maintained on it, you should vaccinate every 5 years. Okay. So in summary, hopefully, I have shown you that some biologic agents increase the risk of infections. There are established associations. For example, TNF-alpha inhibitors increase the risk of Hep B and TB. Anti-CD20 agents risk of hepatitis B and PML. But there's always more to learn. So I think the big take-home point here is that you need to look up these agents, no? You need to be familiar with some buzzwords, and associations are helpful. So for example, an agent we did not discuss is natalizumab. It also has a lot of association with PML. Again, eculizumab is Neisseria. Retux is hepatitis B. Alemtuzumab, think HIV in a bottle, so CMV, PCP, TB. And then basiliximab and daclizumab actually have no risk of infection or no increased risk that we know about. No? So that's it. Thank you.
Hello, oops. Good morning. Magandang umaga po ulit. Thank you to the organizers for having me give a short talk on how to prepare our patients, our transplant candidates, as they are being considered for organ or stem cell transplant. And so this is the outline. We're going to go through some of the common infections, discuss some of the approaches in preventing infections, as well as how do we as infectious disease providers help prepare all our transplant candidates so that they have successful transplant outcomes as they undergo the procedure. The basic principle really is looking at both the pathogen as well as the host. So just like in any infection, you consider the two players, the organism and the host. But in transplant, it's really the host that's probably driving a large part of what the clinical syndrome will be because of the immunosuppression that we give our patients. And when we say immunosuppression, it's either physical, like breach in physical and mucosal barriers. You know, stem cell transplants, they commonly have mucositis, so basically their intestinal tract is denuded and basically portal entry for organisms, for example. Deficiencies in humoral immune responses, but the biggest part really is a deficiency in your T cells. This is your lymphocyte. So lymphocyte is the good immune system that prevents a lot of our opportunistic infections, similar to HIV. Where's the music coming from? Okay. Okay, there you go. So similar to HIV, when the T cell is impaired, patients are at risk for opportunistic infections. And in transplantation, the T cell is impaired because of the drugs that we give. So if you look at this, this is your anti-thymocyte globulin. Dr. Abad mentioned about alemtuzumab. So these two drugs that we give post-transplant, they're given to prevent rejection, but they also are able to basically wipe out the T cell population. They're so-called the T cell depleting agent. The reason why they're called depleting is because they're antibodies against the T cells. So when they are infused in the system, it finds the T cells and lyses all the T cells. So if you measure the T lymphocyte count the day after the infusion, it's almost always down to almost zero. And then there's other groups of drugs such as your calcineurin inhibitors, your mTOR inhibitors, your metabolites, all functioning into the life cycle of your T cell, impairing its function. So it doesn't really deplete the T cell, but it impairs or paralyzes the ability of the cells to recognize antigens. And as a result of that, these are all the common familiar timeline of infections after transplant. Usually, those associated with T cell deficiency happens during this opportunistic infection period. That's when you see your herpes 6 causing encephalitis. That's when you see your cytomegalovirus. That's where you see pneumocystis, cryptococcus, and the like. So we know when they happen. So as infectious disease providers, I usually say we have the role of the 4P. We prepare, we predict because we know when they happen. We then prevent from our patients from developing those infections, and then at the same time protect the outcomes by basically finding the balance of doing enough but doing not too much to cause some dangers as well. So when a transplant candidate come and visit in the clinic, this is usually what we see, what we discuss with the patients. We take a complete history. Do these candidates have high-risk behaviors? High-risk in terms of lifestyle, food habits, pets, outdoor activities, and those kinds of things. Then we also screen them for the presence of latent infections, such as your herpes viruses. So CMV, EBV, varicella zoster are all screened. We screen them for chronic viral infections, such as HIV, Hep B, and Hep C. We screen them for tuberculosis. Again, there's a big topic on LTBI therapy yesterday, but in the United States, everybody gets screened for LTBI and get treated because it's not an endemic area. And we also check them for measles, mumps, and rubella. For those with epidemiologic exposures, we check them for trypanosoma, the Chagas disease, if they are coming from Brazil, for example. Strongyloides, like for example, if I have a transplant candidate coming from the Philippines, I usually check for strongy as well because of the potential for strongy to remain latent for a long time and cause disease post-transplant. And then colonization history, see if they've been colonized with multi-drug resistant organisms. This is usually more common in the lung transplant population. This is the classic endoscopic finding for one of the most common opportunistic infections after transplant. That's your CMV. That's the histopath. Sometimes it's associated with pneumonia. So I discuss with every patient the risk of CMV when they come and visit during their pre-transplant eval, because this is one of the most common infections that may happen. There are occasionally patients who say, "You didn't tell me I'm going to get that." Right? So we actually just basically give them a pamphlet. This is what you may get. And what do we do? So we advise them, you're at risk if you're a mismatch solid organ. You're at high risk if you're a seropositive stem cell transplant. And then you're at even at highest risk if we use alemtuzumab, if we use thymoglobulin, basically depleting the T cells. And then I advise the patients, these are the measures that we do to prevent you from developing CMV disease. We either give you antiviral prophylaxis or we do CMV surveillance. In the United States, where a large proportion is a mismatch in high risk, we give antiviral prophylaxis. The main drug is valganciclovir. in stem cell transplantation, the new drug is letermovir. And then CMV surveillance for the seropositives or moderate risk. This is the classic picture of zoster. So zoster can happen in up to about 20% of transplant recipients, usually about a year or second year after transplantation. So they need to know. And you also need to know their status so that you can prevent this from happening. The CT scan is actually VZV pneumonia that I just saw a few months ago in somebody who basically did not get vaccination prior to transplantation. So during the pre-transplant, we check them for varicella zoster. If they are susceptible, meaning their antibody is negative, we give them the varicella vaccine, right? If they are VZV or varicella seropositive, we give them the Zostavax or Shingrix now to prevent zoster reactivation. Note that the Varivax as well as the Zostavax are live vaccines. So please do not give it post-transplant, and you have to wait 14 to 28 days to perform the transplant if you give it today. Okay? And then for the stem cell transplant population, we also give them acyclovir, usually for up to a year, to prevent zoster reactivation. Again, post-transplant vaccination, it's now possible with Shingrix because that's not live, but do not use Zostavax or Varivax in the post-transplant population, otherwise you're going to have vaccine-associated disease. So what is this? That's a PET scan, and that's the pathology right there of lymphoma. Okay, what's the most common infection that causes lymphoma post-transplant? It's your Epstein-Barr virus. And the high risk and the hallmark really is B-cell proliferation. When Epstein-Barr virus reactivates and causes infection, the B-cells proliferate. That's why it's called infectious mononucleosis. Naglalaki ng mga lymph nodes. Those are all B-cells that are hyperproliferating. And in the presence of immune dysfunction, whenever the cells proliferate, there's always going to be an abnormal cell that is a product, right? In healthy individuals, that abnormal cell that gets produced gets killed by the immune system. But in transplant, because the immune system is suppressed, that mutated cell will proliferate. So those are the risk factors. We do EBV surveillance, and we discuss this, particularly during the pre-transplant evaluation. Like, for example, if the transplant patient comes to me and I know that he is EBV seronegative, so he has not had EBV infection in the past, more likely he will also get a CMV or an EBV positive donor because the majority of humans are EBV seropositive. And if that's the mismatch, I take a pause and say, do you really need to go for transplant now? Usually, it kind of depends on the urgency of the situation, but if it is an elective transplant, I usually say, wait. And because of the risk of lymphoma. This is a picture of a really interesting case that I saw about a year ago now. So somebody with last 10 minutes. All right, LTBI treated candidate. This is a patient coming from Somalia, went to the United States, got a kidney transplant. 2 months after transplantation, the lymph nodes got enlarged, turned out to be tuberculosis. So it's reactivation TB post-transplant. And she also had this abscess at the scalp, which was basically aspirated. It grew tuberculosis as well. So latent tuberculosis is something that we screen in all our transplant candidates. We do history, particularly with exposures in endemic areas, chest x-ray, IGRA, or tuberculosis skin testing is done. We generally advise that they get treated prior to transplant to prevent or reduce the risk of reactivation. And the treatment is either with INH or rifampin. There's now that trial that shows rifampin for 4 months is as good as INH for 9 months, just to kind of point that out. If you are unable to treat prior to transplant, and that is the clinical situation in liver transplants, for example, because they have impaired liver function, so everybody's afraid about rifampin and INH, you can always do the treatment in the post-transplant setting. And we do discuss this with our transplant candidates whenever they come. So this is the summary. Based on candidate screening, we advise them about the risk for CMV, about the risk for EBV, zoster, LTBI. If they happen to be positive for HIV, then that's some sort of a relative contraindication, unless it's controlled. If they are active for hepatitis C, then they get treated with direct antiviral therapy. If they are susceptible to hepatitis B, then they should get vaccinated prior to the transplant. And if they are positive for syphilis, they get treated. And if they're susceptible to measles, mumps, and rubella, then they get the vaccine prior to transplant to prevent them from getting primary infection in the post-transplant setting. Strongy. Do you screen for Strongy? Oh, well, I don't screening. So there are some actually countries where Strongy is endemic, where they just give ivermectin post-transplant to older patients to kind of prevent strongyloides from reactivation. And then if your transplant candidate is colonized with multi-drug resistant organisms, like for example, if you know that the patient is MRSA colonized, then you just don't use cefazolin for perioperative prophylaxis. You have to kind of adjust it based on the colonization history. This is a report that highlights the risk of donor-derived infection. This is just a letter to the New England Journal of Medicine, wherein a donor donated organs to three recipients. The recipients develop encephalitis post-transplant immediately, causing death and encephalopathy. Looking back, the donor had a pet squirrel. So what do you get from a squirrel? That's a Borna disease virus. They said, what is that? So it's basically a disease present in squirrels that can be transmitted to humans through organ transplantation. You see these reports, rabies, West Nile, all those kinds of things. So a donor with encephalitis, a deceased donor with encephalitis is a big no-no in the United States. So in addition to that, we screen also our donors against these types of latent infections or active infections. Of course, if the donor is found to be HIV positive, then that's, it's a big no-no. You cannot use it unless it's an HIV positive to HIV positive transplant, which we still don't do in the Philippines, but it's being done as a research in the United States. If the donor is hepatitis C positive, he can be an organ donor as long as they have the ability to treat the recipient post-transplant, noting that the direct antiviral agents against hepatitis C are quite expensive. This is a big issue in the United States because of opioid crisis. I was looking at Twitter this morning and they said for the second year, the life expectancy in the United States has declined. Then I said, it's time to get back to the Philippines. And the reason why it declined is because of the opioid crisis. There's a lot of people dying from drug overdose. And because of that, there's a lot of potential organ donors. And those are usually high risk. And we can use them as long as we have screening mechanisms. So we check them for hepatitis C, we check them for HIV, as well as hep C. And this is basically the algorithm for that. In addition to all those testing, we also take advantage during the visit to the pre-transplant ID evaluation to basically discuss high-risk behaviors. We take this as an opportunity to prepare our transplant candidates for safe living after transplant. What pets do you have? Do you have cats? Do you have dogs? Do you have horses? Do you have turtles? Some people have snakes as pets. So all of those are discussed to mitigate the risk of infection in the post-transplant setting. Do you like gardening? Where's the water supply coming from? Where do you like to travel, right? Travel prior to and post-transplantation. As well as, do you have even kids at home? Because, you know, especially kids, they go to school, they bring viruses with them back at home. So those are things that we discuss with our transplant recipients. Not because they're going to get it, but just because so that they are aware that these are the potential risks so that they can mitigate the risk post-transplant. That's the cats with toxoplasma. Some people eat their meat raw, and that could be a vector for potential infections. Salmonella and Campylobacter. Some have iguanas as pets, so high risk for salmonella, for example, and snakes, salmonella. Gardening, this is a bear. Some people likes to hunt bear and eat bear meat. That's the hepatitis E outbreak ongoing. So, and then hepatitis E is just like hepatitis A, but in the transplant setting, hepatitis E can become chronic. Okay, and then where do they travel? Okay, when they go for travel, you advise them, okay, these are the types of infections that you may get when you go to Brazil, when you go to Indonesia or to Thailand, so that they can get basically advice as to how to best protect themselves. So at the time of transplant, we prevent surgical site infections. We initiate prevention for opportunistic infections with the strategies listed here against herpes simplex, CMV, preventing UTI as well as pneumocystis. So these are all discussed. But there's a limit to what we do. We do not want to overdo things because giving too much can lead to some potential toxicities. Like our protocol is you give for kidney transplant, you give cefazolin for 24 hours. That's actually probably even more. You probably just need a dose. But most programs use 24 hours. Do not extend the prophylaxis beyond 24 hours because you're going to get C. diff. You're going to get antimicrobial resistance. You're going to get drug toxicities, for example. So those are the things that we do and advise the team members, the surgeons, really, to say their 48 hours is not better than 24 hours, for example, for antimicrobial prophylaxis against surgical site infections. So our role as infectious disease providers is to prepare our transplant candidates, predict what they may get, institute measures to prevent infections, and at the same time, basically contribute to protecting transplant outcomes by being good stewards in what we do. And those are just some of the measures. And this is actually a picture of the multidisciplinary transplant team. It's a cartoon from my institution at the Mayo Clinic, wherein the transplantation is not only the surgeon. The outcome is really a collaborative effort between the surgeons, the hepatologists, nephrologists, infectious disease physicians, pharmacists, nurses, custodians, and all those things in trying to kind of improve outcomes post-transplant. And with that, thank you for your attention.
Program is about infections. So it's about antimicrobial stewardship program in the management of transplant infections. So thank you, Raymond, for the segue to ASBs. So as I was given the topic, I actually thought about, is there really a difference between the ASB program in the general population and the ASB program in the transplant? And though there are some differences, it's basically the same, except that we try to be more aggressive in the diagnosis and empiric treatment in transplant patients. But generally, once we have all the information we need, we have to learn to de-escalate. So the outline of my talk would be dealing with first, what is antimicrobial stewardship program. Next, I will give you hopefully examples of our antimicrobial stewardship program at National Kidney and Transplant Institute. And third, I would be giving some vignettes or cases also of how we handle our transplant patients. So, what is antimicrobial stewardship? It is, since it was rolled out to all hospitals since a year or so ago, we are very familiar with it. These are coordinated interventions designed to improve and measure the appropriate use of antibiotic to prevent antimicrobial resistance. So it promotes the selection of the optimal drug regimen based on the dosing, the duration of therapy, and the route of administration. The goals are simple: to improve patient outcomes. So we want to reduce morbidity and mortality. We want to reduce length of hospital stay, healthcare expenditures, and adverse drug events, including secondary infection, more commonly for C. difficile. So I'd like to give you the 6 core elements of the Department of Health's National AMS program. The first is building an AMS committee and team, usually headed by an infectious disease specialist, if available in that institution. Very important are the policies and the formation of standardized clinical guidelines and clinical pathways which help the physician align the diagnosis and management. Then we measure antimicrobial utilization and antimicrobial resistance through our hospital antibiogram. The next is our action. We have 2 types: persuasive interventional strategies like audit and feedback, and restrictive interventional strategies, for example, restricting certain antibiotics by pre-authorization and a 7-day automatic stop order. Then comes the hard part, which is training and continuous education of our staff. And then the performance evaluation, measuring clinical indicators like percentage of approval of restricted antibiotics and defined days of antimicrobial. So what will be the challenges of stewardship in the transplant population? First, in dealing with immunocompromised patients, they tend to have drug-resistant bacteria, and their infections tend to be severe with rapid progression. So it makes us want to give them broader spectrum of empiric antibiotic coverage than the usual. Usually, they have varied etiologies. Usually, they are frequently co-infected, resulting in multiple antibiotics and duplication in the spectrum and hesitancy to de-escalate. Sometimes, we give longer duration than necessary out of fear that they will succumb to the infection without considering the severity, burden of disease, and the rapidity of clinical improvement. So I just like to tell you a bit about transplant, and these are my 2 patients. CA was a 38-year-old male, 2 months after transplant, presents with a 10-day history of cough and colds only, not even fever, no desaturation. The X-ray revealed I'm not sure if it's very clear, but 3 nodular lesions. When we did the CT scan, we had 3 nodules in different locations. The first thing we did was do sputum test, and it was positive for tuberculosis. The sputum was also positive for nocardia. When we have nodular lesions, we want to biopsy everything, and the biopsy of the 2nd nodule was positive for nocardia, and the 3rd was positive for mucor. So at the same time, the patient had TB, nocardia, and mucor. So we proceeded with the treatment. He had 1 year of anti-TB treatment, 6 months of imipenem, then later cotrimoxazole, and he underwent surgery for mucormycosis. He is 2 years post-transplant now, and he is doing well. My other patient is J.O., a 32-year-old female who presents 7 months after transplant with, sorry, nauna yung slide. Who presents 7 months after transplant with severe back pain and cough. And this was the X-ray. A high-resolution CT showed a cavitary lesion in the right upper lobe. And these are the CT scans of the patient. So, revealing a cavitary mass in the right upper lobe with pneumonia and granulomata. So, the sputum study showed that she had Klebsiella, sensitive to ertapenem, so she was placed on that. The TB tests were negative, and the galactomannan for fungus was negative. So, of course, we did a CT-guided biopsy of the mass, and it was negative for bacteria, TB, nocardia, initially negative for fungus. So what would be the diagnosis? The histopathologic slide showed severe acute on chronic inflammation with hemorrhage, consistent again with mucormycosis. So our patient, 7 months post-transplant, had mucormycosis, which she underwent resection for that, and lipid amphotericin B, which was discontinued a few weeks after transplant, and she's doing fine. So these are just to show you that our patients on transplant need a lot of antibiotic, but more importantly, we have to be very aggressive with the diagnostic strategies. So what are the strategies for transplant AMS? Well, we should develop guidelines and strategies to reduce antibiotic therapy to the shortest effective duration and de-escalate antibiotics at the soonest possible time. We have to develop syndrome-specific clinical practice guidelines with dissemination and implementation. We have to be very aggressive in our diagnostic modalities. And I've been discovering recently that there, in the Philippines, there is a role for point-of-care tests like non-culture-based testing with PCRs, which can identify viral, bacterial, fungal, and parasitic agents, and even galactomannan testing for aspergillus. So I just like to tell you about our clinical pathway for post-transplant pneumonia. So when we have a patient with pneumonia, we will do X-rays and CT scans. So in the X-ray, if they have consolidative lesions, we do sputum cultures and Legionella in the sputum and in the urine. However, because of the very low yield of the Legionella test, we've recently adapted to just treating them with macrolides. When we have a nodular or mass lesion, then we'll do bacterial culture, fungal culture, nocardia test, TB test, and we always make it a point, if accessible, to do CT-guided biopsy, because we find that the cultures may take a long time, but we can have our diagnosis with the histopathology and serum galactomannan for aspergillus test in the blood. If we have an interstitial lesion, we do sputum or bowel culture, Legionella DFA. We will do CMV testing in the sputum and in the blood as well, and PCP antigen test. These are our basic. And lately, I'd like just to tell you that we've had good experience with PCR-based bacterial and viral tests. So just to show you an example, if we do tests for pneumonia, it will probably take us 48 hours to identify the pathogen. But if we do PCR testing for respiratory pathogens, we get viruses and bacteria. and the results come out within the day. Actually, they promise that it can come out as early as 2 hours after the testing. However, you would see that the bacterial test in this is just limited. So we still have to do our cultures, and they will not provide us with any sensitivity report. If a patient in transplant is having diarrhea, then we will do fecalysis, stool for C. diff, stool culture, modified AFB for Cryptosporidium and Isospora. But if we do a PCR test for an array of gastrointestinal pathogens, we get bacteria, viruses, parasites, including Entamoeba histolytica, within the day. So it makes it better because we are able to de-escalate the antibiotics confidently and send the patient home if they have only amoebiasis. If they have CNS infections, we usually do a culture, antigen test for strep, H flu, Neisseria, E. coli, India ink, callus, and TB. But if we do the film array test, then they can give us bacterial, viruses, and yeast. What is missing in the film array would just be TB. So there is a role for point of care tests, including PCR, in our immunocompromised patients. So another strategy for transplant AMS is to develop stratified antibiograms to assist us in developing guidelines for empiric therapy. Knowing that the antibiogram for transplant is probably different from an antibiogram for the general population in a hospital, we have to incorporate facility-specific antibiograms into the pathway, of course, assess adherence and provide feedback, and implement EMR, or electronic medical record-based clinical decision support. Just like to show you our clinical pathway for complicated UTI. If we have patients with symptoms of UTI and lab tests consistent with UTI, then we have to define conditions that define complicated UTI, like anatomic conditions, renal transplantation, diabetes, immunosuppressive conditions, and etc. Then we have to do our diagnostic tests, including urine culture, ultrasound, and if warranted, blood culture, CT sonogram, and urodynamic studies. Then we assess if the catheter can be removed. If not, we want to assess the empiric antibiotic, of course, by a review of the previous cultures and a referral for evaluation through a urologist if we find that an anatomic abnormality is present for source control. And these are our empiric antibiotic treatment based on our antibiogram, which is different probably from your antibiogram, but we can start them with piperacillin tazobactam or ertapenem or meropenem or amikacin. And what is important is to de-escalate after the urine culture results are in. So in adult ICUs with suspected infection, we can also use serial procalcitonin measurements as an intervention to decrease antibiotic use. There is formulary review and restriction, and we do pre-authorization and prospective audit and feedback. It's a peer-to-peer educational outreach to improve the prescribing practices. We do antibiotic timeouts and stop orders, like the 7-day automatic stop order, to encourage the prescribers to perform a routine review of antibiotic regimens to improve antibiotic prescribing. So this is just a slide to tell us the differences between pre-authorization pre-authorization and prospective audit and feedback. So in pre-authorization, wherein you restrict an antibiotic and you require them to adhere to your guideline, it reduces initiation of unnecessary or inappropriate antibiotic. It optimizes empiric choices and influence downstream use. It prompts review of clinical data and prior cultures at the time of initiation of the antibiotic. It decreases antibiotic costs, including those due to high-cost agents. It provides a mechanism for rapid response to antibiotic shortages, and it directly controls antibiotic use. With prospective audit and feedback, it can increase the visibility of the ASP program and build collegial relationships because you actually talk to the doctors. More clinical data will be available for recommendations, enhancing uptake by prescribers. We have greater flexibility in the timing of the recommendations, can be done less than daily, on a less than daily basis. It provides educational benefits actually to clinicians. Prescriber autonomy can be maintained, and we can address the escalation of the antibiotics and the duration of therapy, although this is more labor intensive for the ASP team. Now, another strategy is dose optimization. So we have to educate them on PK/PD strategies. And including here is the PK monitoring for certain drugs. What is available here is vancomycin. And of course, we have to educate them on possible drug-drug interactions. That's why our antibiotics are not working. On the timely transmission from IV to oral, on the length of antibiotic use, and more importantly, on source control. So I think the barriers in transplant stewardship or in stewardship in general are the following. There is usually a culture of hierarchy, a culture of non-interference, and perception that probably transplant patients are exempt from AMS. But they do need AMS, and in summary, immunocompromised hosts are not exempt. What we can do is develop syndromic clinical guideline development with incorporation of rapid diagnostic test and transplant-specific antibiogram into the pathway. We have to be concerned with dissemination, implementation, and education about the drug-drug interaction, dose optimization, duration of treatment, and source control. So this is my last slide. Thank you.
Thank you for that very comprehensive talk for our three